The budgets for both the annual and the special.
We're on. Good evening. This format for the presentation tonight will be as follows. We will be getting an overview of the budget from bottom line numbers of revenue, general expenses, warrant articles, and capital requests. We're looking for each of the three... Three expenditure areas, omnibus budget, the warrant articles, and the capital in detail. And there will be an opportunity to ask questions. And if there's burning questions, do not hesitate to raise your hand or draw your attention to us. As Doug has already told you, there's handouts on the table over here. It would be great if you had them so that you could refer to them as we go through them. And you can also get them on www.deerfieldma.us. The presentation is requesting that you hold the questions till the end.
You don't have to.
So.
The town of Deerfield funds its operations through a variety of sources, including property tax, local receipts for a number of services, fees for buildings and other permits, state cash, and free cash. The budget for fiscal 17 appears to show a large increase in local receipts. This is because some funding sources which were previously held in revolving funds are now being folded into the general budget. These revolving funds are reserved for specific expenses, which are also being folded into the general budget. Therefore, the additional revenue and the additional expense are expected to balance out. So it's not actually additional money. In addition, the Finance Committee has requested a hold on a certain amount of free cash, and I believe that's approximately $300,000. So the total available revenue for 2017 is $14,987,413. This represents an increase of $835,284, which is about 5.9%. Town's operations, including schools, police, public works, general government, and other town departments, are consolidated into the omnibus budget. This year's budget request is $13,475,859, which represents an increase of $394,846, or about 3%. Okay, Mark, I'm sorry.
It's okay. I think we skipped a page, but that's okay. Special requests for fundings will appear in the town meeting warrant as articles. As it has in the past. These include funding for wastewater treatment, regional costs and assessments, Smith vocational costs, and other one-time requests for special projects. Total requests for funding for FY17 are $1,206,000 and $955. That's a correction. So in your books, it says $2,066,000. It's actually $2,006. I didn't misread that one. So we'll review those in detail later in this presentation. The warrant articles are $1 million. Oh, that's a correct. You got to correct that one too. Just repeating it as a sign there. Is that better? Jonathan.
Funding for capital requests are first presented to the Capital Improvements Committee for their recommendation. Capital requests may be funded from various sources. Total recommended capital requests for fiscal 2017 are $174,599, which will be funded through the general fund, and $130,000, which will come from the wastewater reserves. for a total of $304,599. The bottom line for this budget, fiscal 17, is $14,987,413. This is an increase of $835,284 over fiscal 16. General government services include all administrative functions of town government. Selectmen and administration for fiscal 16, the request was $170,906. For fiscal 17, the request is $164,373, a reduction of $5,600. Town accountant, the town accountant's budgets are higher for fiscal 17 due to a request for an increased salary. This is request is made by the town administrator and the board of selectmen and recognizes the current pay rate of our town accountant is significantly below market rate for the position. And also there just are not very many accountants available and ours is wonderful. The fiscal 2016 request was $54,612 and the 17 request is $57,831. This increase is about $2,700. The assessor's proposed budget is slightly higher due to salary adjustments. Fiscal 16 request was $78,756 and the request for 16 is, oh, it should be 17. I'm sorry. The request for 17 is $79,584, which is about $830 increase.
Allow me to take a moment to interrupt. I noticed some folks in the audience are kind of squinting at the handout that they've received and are wondering, I'm guessing, where the numbers are coming from. In many of these cases, we're combining multiple line items that you see on the sheet into a single number. So, for example, the selectman administration includes both the selectman salaries, the selectman staff salaries, and the selectman administrator expense combined.
So the accountant figures are accountant salary and accountant expense.
That's correct.
Added together.
He's got it.
Got it.
If anyone has a question, just raise your hand because, I mean, this is the whole point of going over this. Clerk, treasurer, collector, the proposed budgets for the clerk, treasurer, collector's office show an increase due to salary adjustments and a $10,000 increase in expense. Fiscal 16 was $195,778. For 17, the request is $200,287, an increase of about $14,500. Land use and planning. And zoning, the Planning Board, Conservation Commission, Zoning Board of Appeals, Open Space Committee, and the Agricultural Committee helped to oversee and manage land use in Deerfield. The total fiscal 16 request for these boards and committees was $9,400. The 17 request is $9,250, a decrease of $150. Town Hall operations include funding for legal services, contracted services, general insurance, town hall supplies and utilities, and town hall maintenance. The main drivers of these expenses are energy costs, including heating and electricity. For fiscal 17, per request of the Department of Revenue, we're including the PEG access television costs. These costs represent a $77,000 increase, but there is a corresponding new revenue stream which balances out this increase. Aside from the PEG access increase, these budgets actually show a net reduction of about $7,000. The fiscal 16 request was $277,847. And the fiscal 2017 request is $345,214, an increase of $67,400. Broadly speaking, UMAS 2000 series. Oh, go ahead, John. I'm sorry.
The request, is that by the department head? Who makes the request? There's a column that says request, and the column says recommended.
Well, we have department heads or committee people put together their budget.
And then we look at it. Committee.
And then we recommend, the Board of Selectmen recommends, and then the finance recommend, or we request, and then the finance committee recommends or not recommends.
The request is the selectman's request to the town.
Okay.
The recommendation comes from either the finance committee or whatever oversight board governs.
Thank you. There's a lot of time involved in that. It's the request is,
and it goes back and forth until we kind of think we have a balanced budget or close to balance.
One second. Go ahead,
okay.
Bruce.
All right, just curious, what fed the $57,000 increase in the town hall operations?
The town hall operations, we included. Okay, the town hall operations includes funding for legal services, contracted services, general insurance, town hall supplies and utilities, and town hall maintenance. The main drivers of these expenses are energy costs, including heating and electricity. For 2017, per the request of the Department of Revenue, we had to include the PEG access television costs, which are about approximately $77,000 increase, but there is also a corresponding net revenue stream that Comcast pays us, so which balances off the increase. So in actuality, if you take out that $77,000 PEG access increase, the budget actually shows a net reduction of about $7,000. I know it's very confusing, but we had to do this because of DOR. Or, you know, they suggested heavily that we include that in our budget. Bruce.
Yes, in 2017, Skimbs will be making an administrative payment to the town. Have the offsets been applied to each of the categories that are included that make up the 10%?
They can't be. I think I would defer to Brenda, but I believe they cannot be in the same fiscal year. They're seen as a revenue line item,
okay,
but they can't be applied directly to offset the departmental expenses. They have to be taken in as revenue, counted after the end of the year as free cash and certified, and then those monies can be made use of in the following fiscal year.
So with 16 that we're voting on the special town meeting, where will those revenues go?
Those revenues will fall into free cash. They will basically fall into that nebulous zone after July 1 and will turn into free cash once it's certified in September or October.
What happens, do you understand free cash in the, yeah, okay. It's just they, after June 30th, we just can't use free cash until it's recertified in the fall.
I understand. The issue is that it is used at least in the following year's budget as a reduction to the taxpayers.
And it is.
It will be in 18 budget?
Sure. Yeah.
All the money is counted as general funds and basically offsets how we pay our bills and where we have end up being at for what the taxpayers get billed out. It's,
yeah, we've already paid this in taxes. I just don't want to.
We've been using free cash to cover our operating budget for so when it goes into free cash, it will be covering the operating budget for next year. Just because I don't
think that means there should be a decrease in these line items in 18, if that's the case.
We can't plan on.
What you're saying is we need to take out.
You need to account for the money that's coming in from Skimbs and make it allocated towards the.
Like Brenda's budget, what you're saying is Brenda's salary line, the amount that she pays, or works percentage is accrued to the Skimbs, should not be included in the taxpayer's budget.
Because when I look at these numbers, we're using 17's budget numbers to create 18's budget, and there's going to be a major increase in charge from the town, from poor Skimbs administratively. Major increase. Instead of 58,000, it could be 65, 70,000.
Well, it's a good suggestion. We'll look at how to do it. It's the same thing we're doing with, you know, insurances and things that actually put them in the places where they belong. This is the first year we're getting the revenues into the town of Deerfield for this, and basically it will balance itself out. Unfortunately, you had two lean years where we didn't get any money in, but we still paid the services, and now we're getting money in, and it will be applied basically in general as general funds against the whole operations of the facility.
It will be an anomaly.
Any comments from that on that? Are we hitting it, or are we just talking around the subject?
Did you find the finance committee was okay with? I mean, we're collecting the money. It's just coming in at a lump sum.
Yeah, one year.
Oh, I'm sorry. Bruce's question was that it's going to distort next year's cash flow because we're getting this 3 years worth of administrative expenses in 1 year. But I mean, that's how free cash operates. We, you know,
you don't get free cash until the end of the fiscal year.
Right.
Right.
But he's
for the next year.
Right. But what he's saying is that because we've got, if you consider it 3 years, we've got $160,000 worth of revenues coming in this year, which will skew as the money comes, as you start looking at the pots of money next year. And if we use the same thing.
We'll do the same thing next year.
I know.
No, it'll be a lot less. It'll be actually just one payment instead of. And remember, basically, we're paying ourselves back for half of that money, so it's not real. It's not really that large of a sum of money. It's more of a closer to $80,000 for the 3 years. Anything else?
What do we vote on at the town meeting for total spending, the requested or the recommended?
It's going to be up to the town meeting to decide.
It'll be the motion. We'd vote for what will happen is there'll be a motion made. I assume that if there's a discrepancy between the two of them, it will be based upon what the Board of Selectmen puts in, and the Finance Committee will advise the townspeople whether we're on the mark or not on the mark, and the vote will be either modified by a motion or corrective to the motion, or the motion will stand and we'll vote on it, and if it passes, good. If it doesn't, then we go back to the drawing board.
But everyone's okay with the pay? I mean, it does look like it went up, but it balances out, so it's actually was a decrease. Okay. Broadly speaking, the 200 series includes fire, police, ambulance, and building inspection service. The Deerfield's fire districts are outside the scope of this budget, and the ambulance services are through South County EMS, is handled in a separate warrant article. Therefore, the public safety operations includes the two remaining departments, police operations and inspections. Police operations include funding for salaries, operations, capital expenses, and Deerfield's
participation.
I'm sorry, in the regional animal control district. That's with Montague and Greenfield. We sent this up a couple years ago. This year, the budget increase is primarily due to a formal addition and funding for a school resource officer. This position is partially funded through a gift of $30,000 from the Deerfield Private Schools, and we gratefully acknowledge the generosity of this gift. In 2016, the funding request for police services was $832,486. For fiscal 17, the request is $887,732. Taking into account the $30,000 gift, the net increase to this budget is about $25,000. Yes.
Can gifts always be earmarked for a particular purpose? In the past, I remember, you know, that the town would accept this from this school or that school. Is this the way it's always been? Can they do this? Aren't they kind of dictating? I mean, how does that work?
This was separate than the gift that's sort of like, we don't have pilot payments with them because they do not have to give a gift. They give us a gift in lieu of taxes, and this was a separate gift that was for the resource officer.
So how did that come about?
They utilize some of the time of that officer, and they believe in the program.
She's asking a mechanical question. Right. The reality is we created last year a fund for this event that people could put money into this process. It's no different than the recreational's revolving fund or the senior centers. They can give money into those gifted accounts, and it was earmarked for that gifted account for their applications. That's how it got there, but it was done by annual town meeting. We established the account, and then we were allowed to, after we establish it, to put money into it.
Whoever can donate,
if we go out and actively look for senior housing, and we can establish a fund for senior housing and start the seed money for it, we can actually set up a fund for it and then go out and request people to consider giving gifts to that arena. And
it's
that's
just
what
interesting, oh sorry, with the private schools, because a lot of their own disciplinary action is handled in-house.
Correct.
So, I mean, I dare say I had a couple of kids who went through and it didn't get out.
Right.
They handle it in-house.
Well,
so I'm curious, what's the benefit to the private schools? You know, I'm just...
Well, what's happened over the years since our kids were in school was that, they're just... Number one, the state has mandated school resource officers, unless your police chief signs off and saying that it feels like there's no threat or need in the town. And we would never put our police officer, our police chief in that position, because obviously things can happen. And over the years, there's just a lot of stuff going on, like with technology and the internet and different events.
Okay.
And so let me just finish this real quick. So, and I had gone to a symposium, active shooter symposium, and we've had some events at Frontier. And so what has emerged is that there has been a need for a resource officer, which we as a select board have supported. But it's the $30,000 doesn't cover the entire cost, nor does it cover the insurance. So we were hoping to get this covered. We created this account, so we were hoping to get it covered by our dispensary, marijuana dispensary, that the license hasn't been issued yet. So it's in the police budget instead of being totally funded separately.
And I apologize for being late to the party, but could you give me a definition of exactly what the resource officer's duties would be? Or is that just kind of a...
Well, I think one of the most important things is you're actually, and this is why Deerfield Academy supports this, is you're actually buying the presence of an officer. You're buying the presence of the officer so that the kids get to know him, and that hopefully if there's something happening, that somebody would be willing to go, because they know the officer, they would be confined into the officer.
So you're like, saying that they'll go to an officer rather than the staff or the dorm parents or teachers. I mean, that's why I can't wrap my head around this. There's teachers and there's staff that deal with elementary, high school. They live in the dorms at Deerfield Academy, Eagle Brook, Bemen. Well, that's a little young. They know their kids. They're with them all day. The teachers in the classroom, they see the changes. So that's why I'm looking.
And that's
really
why,
what does that mean, a resource officer?
Deerfield Academy is not looking for a resource officer at their facility. The resource officer is for the public schools' agendas. And the reason that Deerfield Academy subscribes to it is because they're looking for a school community that gives an equal opportunity across the board. And it's not that they're looking for someone to take the place of that person in the room or the teacher or anything else. They're looking for somebody, one, to create a bond between law enforcement and young kids so they're not afraid of them, and two, that basically it allows them to see something, say something type of agenda, so that basically if they see something, rather than having to go through the come down to the police station or make a 911 call, or they can actually look these people up at lunch or some other time and have a discussion with them. And we hope that the classes that they teach and the classes that they get involved in help instill that law enforcement attitude towards the town, their peers, and everything else. It seems to be working across the country. We think it's valuable at this point to be part of it. And so does Deerfield Academy, which is funding a portion of it.
Well, it just seems like I've never heard the teachers, and when my kids were in school and in the high school and being involved in working there, that I never heard anyone say, oh, I wish we had this. So well, I understand that the chief is in a tough position if this is a mandate, and maybe he sees this as an opportunity to get another officer, which, you know, why not, I guess, if we can support it. But, I mean, we have to look at the whole big picture. School's 180 days a year. So I assume this resource officer, what happens the other days? You know, I mean, I just would like to get a better feel of exactly what this job would be.
Well,
because it seems like somebody would say, boy, we wish we had someone that could do this. Okay, how about a resource officer? And it seems like we're getting the resource officer, and then we're going to, like, figure out what
and we'll have really good, and the chief will be able to speak to that at the town meeting floor. But
well, I thought that's what this was for. To
yes.
Get a little,
well, he's not here today, and that is a specific question. But I have to say, technology is available to very young kids now, and it's 24/7. And when our kids were in school, you could pick up your kid would come home, and there was like a break. There's no break anymore, and that's one of the things, you know, the internet, the use of the internet, and you know, bullying and stuff like that is much more severe because you can't escape it anymore, and it's the whole social media thing is very scary for parents. And part of this is, you know, the whole Instagram, Snapchat, all that stuff is to give guidance to parents and to see, you know, keep on top of things, what's happening in the schools, and intervene before it gets to be more serious. And and you're not supposed to do a position based on the person, and I'm sure the chief would always pick a good person, but you know, Brian Ravish has had really good reviews for the few months that he's been doing it, and I feel it very strongly that this is a good thing for us as a community, because our number one job is to protect our kids. And so I'm sure the chief will be able to speak on town meeting floor if specific questions, or you could call him and talk to him and get specific answers, because these are valid questions, and I feel pretty inadequate to be able to answer them, except to say that we support this so much, and if there's any opportunity for intervention, it is so worth, you know, having this officer.
Well, it makes more sense in what you're talking about with the whole social media. I mean, that is something that almost makes more sense.
And I know there has been
me.
A few interventions already that were very successful, right. and having that police presence in a friendly way, and having that relationship really makes a huge difference on how it the resolution of it. So,
Jay,
Carol, just very quickly, it's too bad Chief Pichurk wasn't here, because this is amazing, the information that he could spill out. But one point, he did say that regular officers work 3 days on, two off. But there's an arrangement that's legally done where this officer works 5 days, so that offsets that summertime.
You know what, Ralph? Thank you so much, because I forgot that. He's able to work every day of the school schedule, which is not contracted, Diane. So that.
And the only other quick point I make is that we frequent up to Franklin County trade school, and we're amazed at the relationship that officer has with those kids, and those kids have with that officer. And down in Northampton, when we were there, there was, I think his name was, is it Russ or Rust? and he did the DARE program. And it was a little different, but it was still that same thing. And there's a wonderful camaraderie that builds between the kids and them. And these officers really do prevent and stop a lot of trouble before it gets too big.
Thank you.
Going back to the line items, the inspection department salaries, I see there's an increase of over $35,000 in that one line.
We haven't gotten there yet.
We haven't got down that far yet.
Oh, I thought, well, you were in public safety, and that's it.
Yeah, we answered questions on the police budget, but Diane, if...
Okay. No, that's fine. It's like we're coming in at different directions instead of, like, there's a need. Let's do this.
Well, we had a incident at Frontier last year, which was successfully resolved, but I did go to the Homeland Security, because I'm on the Homeland Security Council, active shooter symposium, and one of the cases that was analyzed was Sandy Hook, and I was supportive of the resource officer anyway, but after that all-day thing, there was no way that I wasn't going to be advocating for a resource officer, just because, if there was any chance that, because 60% of all active shooting is in schools, and if there was any way that you could get a whiff of information, or based on their relationship with the kids, you could have some intervention, it would be so... I mean, we couldn't even question it, so.
Would the officer have a gun when he's in the schools?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Even in the elementary school?
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's not so much that he has a gun, it's just that you'd be able to hear things based on having a relationship with kids, that kids might mention something because he's there. And that's one of the key things that was advocated by, all the FBI people and all the people that were speakers, were that having that presence and that relationship, you have the best chance of preventative and intervention kind of stuff. And so, again, it's a safety issue, and I can't advocate, enough for it.
Okay, thank you.
Inspection services. Do you want to read it?
No, you go ahead.
Okay. Oh, inspection service, 11. Inspection also show an increase for 2017, but this is more than offset by the estimated $50,000 increase in revenues from the plumbing, gas, and wiring inspection fees, which are now being included in the general revenue. For fiscal 2016, it was $74,347. For 17, the request is $114,692, an increase about $40,000. But again, it's offset by revenues of more than 50. So actually, it's making money, Bruce. Okay.
Well, it's anticipated revenues.
Correct.
But we don't have the expense unless that revenues come in first. And, you pay a permit fee and then you get the inspection. So if there is no permit fee, then there's no expense either.
Does the building inspector get paid by the inspection, or is he on salary?
The health inspector and the building inspector is on salary.
So then why would the salaries go up?
All of the other salaries are hourly, for the electrical, the plumbing, the backup building inspector, the wiring inspector. Those are all hourly salaries. The overall cost of the inspections budget went up because previous to this, plumbing, gas, and wiring were paid for out of a revolving fund. Fees went into the revolving fund. Their salaries went out. You guys never saw it on the budget. By rolling this into the budget, the inspection services costs increase, but we also benefit from the revenue from those permit fees. In terms of the revenue that's expected, $50,000 or so, that's a conservative estimate. That's about, I don't know what just happened there. That's about 80%, 85% of a rolling five-year average with really high inspection. Occasionally they'll have inspection fees that are $200,000. Those were not even included in that calculation. So it's an 85% rolling average of a previous 5 years worth of revenues being used to calculate that estimated revenue figure. So town accountant is pretty confident that that's a safe number to go with.
Every year, our free cash, a significant portion of our free cash is generated by building permit fees. And so the building permit, or the commissioner, building commissioner's salary is more than offset by what we collect. Is there any more questions on that? Because we can get more information. John, you don't look very satisfied.
No, I think, be honest with you, I think it's a very confusing presentation. My perspective.
Would it be easier?
How could we make it easier?
Yeah, I mean, do you want us to go?
How can we make it easier?
I guess
make it off the slides?
Like, as using police operations as an example, okay. Which accounts make that up? Which accounts on here make that up? And then if there is a reduction, show that?
Well, the police payroll we requested the resource officer be included, so it was $751,467. The finance committee is recommending $704,114, which is not inclusive of the resource officer. Okay. The police expense is $800 increase from last year. It's $77,800, and we requested that, and the finance committee recommend 77.
No, I don't think we need to go over each, from to answer my question, go over each line item. I just think it would have been easier for me anyway to say which accounts make up the total of 887,732.
Oh, that's the police payroll. Oh, okay, then I can do police payroll. Well,
I don't want to take the time, okay. Everybody's time to do it. You ask why it's hard to understand. You know, you ask why I had a puzzled look. That's
well,
why.
You know, it
but
was.
Don't, it's. I think it's too late now.
Well, I think what the hardship is that we had to include the PEG access for the first time, and we had to include the building inspector fund, revolving fund. We put that into the building inspection general fund.
We'll see if we can make it a little more understandable as we go through the next groups, taking in mind you're looking for bottom lines and how they changed and what the changes are about. So
that's about the only, those two things. I think those are the only things that we had to do, right?
I believe so.
Yeah.
That offsets where there's offsetting new revenue from that offsets expenses, yes. Part of the format's intention was to show a more complete picture of any given department. To talk about each independent budget, for example, for the police department, doesn't show you what the overall department is doing financially. Broadly speaking, the only increase in that department is for the school resource officer, that $55,000 increase. That again, broadly speaking. And all of the other budgets, those four budgets, the police payroll, the expense, the capital request, which is the cruiser, and the canine control, for the most part, see very, very modest increases. The inspections numbers that are on the screen represent both the salaries and the expense for the inspections department. And that was the intention behind the grouping these together in the way that they were. I will certainly grant you that it was a lot more confusing for the first section of budgets, where there were a number of budgets scattered throughout that 100 series.
May I go back to a police department expense question?
Sure.
I know we had to give back literally tens of thousands of dollars on our contract for gas because gas is low. What happened with the gas with like the police department? Or I would assume they use, what happened, where is that? Because I would assume that their cost
police
gas
department
went down also.
Yes, the police department gave back money this year, in some cases.
Or will give back.
How does that, where do we see that, or where is that reflected?
When we
free cash.
It'll go into free cash.
But it would also be nice, as John mentioned, I mean, that would be maybe helpful to learn, because like I said, I know we're all living, you know, you see at the gas pump that gas is that much less. Well, that's great, then you would think people's, the budget would be going down, but then when you look at the budget, it's still the same. And I get it, that gas can go up again.
What happens, all our department heads are really good about at the end of the year, and that's how we generate our free cash for this coming year, is whatever is left over their return. And I believe John was somewhere around 36,000 last year.
But I think that would be nice for people to know. I think it would be good for the townspeople to know that because of this, that the department gave that back.
Well, the problem is,
I mean, I know it's going to get used again for something else.
Yeah, so. I was just going to say,
But do you see what I'm saying? It just shows that he's on, in my opinion, it shows that he's on top. And yes, I saved
absolutely.
In this department, giving it back to the town, and then, of course, it can be used for something else.
That level of detail is certainly available. It is available at the level of essentially an end-of-year fund-by-fund report. The police expense, for example, is one line item on this budget, and traditionally that's how it's been, you know, reviewed and approved at town meeting. But that police department expense, and again, we're just picking on that one for example, includes about 18 or 20 separate sub-items,
right.
One of which is gasoline.
Right.
If you wanted to know how much the police turned back at the end of the year that they did not use in that line item, that is available, but it would only be available through the overall end-of-year budget versus actual, if you will.
Because it seems, you know, what we see is what everybody wants. You know, you go to town meeting and all you hear is this is what this one wants, this is what that one wants. Well, I think me as a taxpayer, and maybe other people might be happy to know that, you know what, they may be looking for this, but they saved over here and they gave this back. But I get what you're saying too. You can't, you know, you can't show every little thing.
And one of the problems too is our end of the year is June 30th.
Right.
So, I mean, and we have an April 25th town meeting, so it's a little bit premature to say that, you know, the police chief, it looks like when we get monthly reports, our accounting software gives us the percentage they use, and usually you can guesstimate how much is coming back just by the fact that they haven't, you know, the percentage spent to date. But You don't know if a car breaks down, transmission goes or something, and at the end of the year you're allowed to transfer some money back and forth. So if there's a salary item that isn't been spent but you had a repair item, you could, you know, up to 5% could be transferred in the line items. And so it's hard to tell, to give you an accurate estimate in April for, you know, June 30th close of the year. So but we do talk about it in July when we're going over the accounts, and we look at how much money is coming back and what was overfunded and what was underfunded. But I have to tell you truthfully, all the budgets are so tight, there's not a lot of wiggle room coming back. But it does go into our free cash, and that's what's certified for September or October of the coming year here. Is there any other questions? We'll go on to the Deerfield School. Deerfield has both the elementary school and a portion of the Frontier Regional School. The Deerfield Elementary School for fiscal 16, the Deerfield Elementary School request was $4,361,539. The request for 17 is $4,469,223. This is an increase of $106,379. And Frontier request was $3,284,940 for 16. The 17 request is $3,488,026. This is an increase of about $203,000. Doug, do you have the percentages?
Yeah. I was just curious what the difference was that the finance committee for the recommendation? It looks like about 9,000 short from requested. I was not sure what that was. Is that a portion of the resource officer?
I don't know. I
no,
don't
there wasn't
know.
Any. There was no allowances for.
I can't remember.
It's because one item for $8,900 is in two different places. It was a new function, but they never took it out of the.
I see.
Great.
Thank you.
Dealing with the IT.
Right.
Double digit.
Okay.
I had nothing to do with the resource officer.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
The schools are not contributing this year to the resource officer. We were hoping to, get the licensing, and it still might come through because it's supposed to be happening right now. But so it might happen before July 1st. Bruce,
is there a reason why you recommended dollar value zero?
For Frontier.
The Finance Committee simply hasn't addressed that budget yet. There's been some questions in regard to, and then a couple of insurance items, and they will be taking this up on Monday. Okay. So it's just the way the spreadsheet works out. They haven't made a recommendation.
Okay, so it's not that they recommend zero. They just...
Yeah, we're pulling out. We're out there. We're done. I'm talking to a reporter, and I'm saying that I'm in trouble.
I can't get sarcasm, so be careful.
It was concerning because Frontier's budget was higher than, but a lot of times it's a formula rotation of the formula and stuff like that. I don't know. We've got to figure that out.
I think to answer your question, I think Deerfield Elementary School's increase was right around 2.5%, between 2.5 and 3. Frontier Regional School's increase was about 6.1% over last year, and a lot of that had to do with the fact that the formula changed. In terms of Deerfield's percentage of Frontier's overall budget, about 1% of that was due to the change in the formula.
We're hoping there's a little wiggle room to be discussed. Public works includes road maintenance, tree clearing, cemetery, sidewalks, maintenance of public grounds and buildings. Also, winter snow, ice removal, street lighting, transfer station operations. It's quite inclusive. The highway department of that, the fiscal 16 request was $652,729. For 17, it's $679,135. This is an increase of about $26,400. This increase is primarily driven by a higher request for tree maintenance services and a small increase to the project's expense line. We have got a lot of tree work in town. There's the list of complaints we have had, and inspection of the trees driving around is quite extensive, so that was one of the reasons the increase has gone up. With the storm events we're having, it's not money. If by cutting that budget, it's a foolish way to save money, because it ends up costing a huge amount of money if we have a storm, and we have them on a regular basis in the last few years. Winter snow and ice removal costs are slightly higher
in 16
due to the addition of the plow hardware in this budget. For 17, the budget is increased by $2,000 to $85,000.
What? Yes.
Okay. This budget may be legally exceeded, allowing for extra winter work that may be needed.
This is also required to be kind of level funded to get money to be reimbursed by the state. If we start cutting the budget back, showing that we're not keeping our irons in there, it can end up costing us money in the long run in reimbursement and Chapter 90 money. So this is a number that it's a floating average that keeps us above, and that $2,000 is going to just move the target up a little bit.
The 2016 was appropriated at $83,000?
Correct.
I would assume the actual is going to come in a lot less than that.
2016, the actual is going to be just slightly less than that. It will be under the 83,000, but it's going to be slightly less.
Maybe slightly?
By comparison, last year, we overspent by about $55,000, if memory serves.
Okay.
So.
All right.
And the other thing that is not really reflected in here is that Kevin is using a lot more salt versus salt and sand. Because under the new DEP rules, you have to clean up the sand that you use. So it's actually very expensive to use sand in the long run. So and also, it's not as effective as using pre-treating with salt and stuff like that. The roads are easier to plow. And we didn't have very much snow this year, but we actually had these piddly little events, and they went over long periods of time where you had to pre-treat the roads, and then you were retreating over and over again. And you know, the guys were out still anyway, and so actually we didn't save as much money as you would think, but it's certainly a reduced amount compared to last year. Is there any more questions on that? And what happens when we get major storms? There is a possibility of reimbursement too through the state, so that's another reason why you have to budget this amount every year, because otherwise then we're not eligible for any reimbursements, as Mark alluded to. Street lighting is funded at $35,000. We've put in more energy efficient bulbs and turned some lights off, so even though the cost of electricity has gone up, it's pretty much stable. And our expenditures. So we're trying to do more of that. And we're going to revisit whether to buy the lights. We've talked about that a few years ago. And we
technology has come up so that basically they're not running as hot and they're lasting longer. So it's probably a time. At the time we did the street light audit, we had just renegotiated having some turned off, and we went through a series of having them marked and went through a vast number of evolutions with Western Mass Electric Company, and it didn't seem appropriate for, after putting that effort into it, to ask the provider to then change out the light bulbs. We're now into it about 3 years. We've shown that we're holding our own electrically wise. Our next step to save energy would be to bring in LED type of lights that would drop the consumption but still be offset by the cost of putting them in plus the electricity. So that's our next endeavor to move forward on street lights.
Transfer station operations include both trash hauling and disposal fees, as well as test well monitoring and maintenance costs. In 16, it was $278,471. In 17, it's $280,100.
That's an increase. I apologize.
Yeah,
you got the wrong word there. Yeah.
That's all right. It's an increase of about $1,700. Kevin's done a lot of work at the transfer station to reconfigure how we pull and haul these things away, and so we're actually operating the transfer station much more efficiently and effectively than we have in the years past. He keeps chipping away at it. So I think it said $1,700. I can't remember exactly why Kevin said it was due to hauling costs, wasn't it?
There is some increase to the hauling costs. Yeah. There were some other savings due to the scheduling of the hauling as well.
Right. Yeah. So you're actually taking away and defraying it.
He defrayed a lot of the costs by organizing the we pull.
Literally. That makes all the difference in the world.
Yeah. The next is human services, includes health, ADA services, senior center, COLA, Council of Aging Operations, and Veterans Benefits. The health services includes inspection and nursing services for fiscal 17 shows an increase due to the hours of health inspections and an increase in the assessment of the town nurse. The request for 16 was $43,388. The request for 17 is $56,117. $3,000 of that, or a small increase, is in the nurse, and mostly it's for additional health inspections.
I'd like to know how much the nurse's contract is with college.
For FY17, if off the top of my head, I believe it's roughly about $20,000 for the year.
I agree. The town nurse is an asset to the community. She has 4 hours a week.
I think it's six.
On the website, it says four.
Okay.
She's here working, and she does home visits and consulting and stuff like that. So hour-wise.
Office hours, she only posts four, but she has a lot more that she's here.
If I was to divide 4 hours a week by 19,000, it's up to $95 an hour.
It's approximately 50-something dollars an hour. We don't pay benefits or... Yeah.
Yep. Home visits, and she does inoculation. She does some of the programs. So.
Follow-ups for, when people are released from the hospital.
We know how many hours a week she averages.
It's about 400 hours a year.
Okay.
We're about 20. We share about 20% of the overall time, her full time.
Mm-hmm. So. And due to the fact that she's housed out of here, she has an office that she can use out of here. She spends a lot more time here than she does at other facilities. She actually has, this is a home base, so we're very lucky to have her in this situation.
Senior, is there any other questions? Okay. Senior services include funding for South County Senior Center and the Council of Aging. The fiscal 2016's request was $28,021. The request for 17 is $24,308. This is a decrease of about $3,700. I think this was offset by a grant, right?
Not offset. I mean, there are grants involved. A number of grants that are involved in helping to maintain the
programs.
We
have additional services. Actually, the
absolutely.
Outreach person.
Yeah, absolutely. This reduction, though. From 16 to 17 is primarily due to the fact that we did not include insurance for the one person eligible, and because of that, there was a reduction in the budget. This could change at any time, which would result in the need to come back and to reappropriate money for this. But after consultation with the folks at the Senior Center, as well as with our town accountant, we decided to go ahead with this reduced budget.
Veterans benefits include funding for veterans in the veterans district. $46,326 was the 16 request. The 17 request is $43,023, a decrease of about $3,300. Part of that is offset by this new district that we joined, mm-hmm. basically. We combined with all the other towns in Greenfield. I think it's almost every town, isn't it?
We were on our own. We combined with Greenfield, which was a bigger player, and basically was able to reduce our allotments. In the fact, because Greenfield becomes a big player and they carry a fair amount of the load, but by doing that, make it more regionalized, we're realizing a better return on the dollar.
And there's a veterans office right on Main Street in Greenfield that, you know, has regular hours and stuff. So it actually is an increase in services, even though it looks like it's a reduction. Culture and recreation includes funding for libraries, outdoor recreation activities, and historic commission expenses. The Tilton Library request was for $157,119. The 16 request is $161,049, and this is an increase of about $3,900. If you, somewhere on here, is that was the salary increase was
cover it.
Was not recommended by the Finance Committee for the extra hours. It's about $800. So there will be discussion on that because the selectmen are still requesting the additional hours. Is there any question on that? It was mostly children's hours, children's library hours. And so. Recreation is funding for recreation department is for salaries. All the program activity is funded through user fees. The request for 16 was $43,242. The 17 request is $43,978. This is an increase of about $730. Tri-Town Beach and Summer Swim Program. The two programs manage activities at Tri-Town Beach. The request for 16 was $25,695. The request for 17 was $26,533. This is an increase of $850. Trevor.
Just noticing they were recommending only 8,000. Was there a drop in services or? Just curious why the 8,000 versus the.
We actually went back 5 or 6 years looking at their budget and their expenses, and they're doing better than they think.
Oh, nice.
So
good.
They've got a reserve so they can cover themselves.
I see.
The Historic Commission is level funded at in 17 at $1,075. The next set of items is the debt service. Actually, so there's a reduction in 16 due to reduced interest. The debt service in 16 was, I think you meant 17, Doug.
I think you're right.
$563,827 was in 16. In 17, it was $551,386. It's a reduction of about $13,500. There's the maturing debt.
You don't have to worry about those details.
Yep.
Unless folks need the information.
Okay. Interest go up. 900 series is benefits, and we do have Barbara here, so if anyone has questions, that's good. She's here to answer them. Includes the cost for workers' compensation, unemployment insurance, Medicare, health insurance, retirement contributions. These costs cover all employees on the town's payroll, including employees at Deerfield Elementary School. In 2016, benefit costs were assessed to some departments that received funding for non-town sources, resulting in a saving to the town. In 16, the benefits funded were $1,448,097. In 17, the request is $1,381,032. This is a reduction of about $67,000. Our insurance actually went up. Our health insurance went up, and Barbara has was really on top of it, and she sent out information because really it was we actually anticipated no increase because we've had no increase for the last few years, but the cost of pharmaceutical drugs went up astronomically. So the increase really was all due to cost of drugs. And so Barbara was really good. She sent out information on, you know, you could buy the drugs in Canada and it would cost the, you know, person less money as a copay as well as us. So we won't really know until the end of the year if there has been an impact. But Hampshire Trust is very responsible. Good manager of our health insurance, and why other groups have had huge increases, we've been able to manage very low or no increases. Mary was there, active participant years before, and now we have Barbara that's doing the same thing, and we're trying everything we can to keep our expenses down, and so hopefully they'll have some impact by, you know, being able to buy drugs through Canada. So, and it seems like it's relatively stable, which is a huge expense for most people. Warrant articles are special funding requests for one-time or recurring expenses. Article 9 is the town's wastewater treatment operations. Total funding request for 17 is $672,611, which represents an increase from 16 of about $163,000. This increase will allow the wastewater department to borrow for facility repairs and improvements. So,
Sorry, I thought you were throwing.
No, go ahead.
How does that come out of general taxation?
No, this is from wastewater revolving fund. Oh, the fees comes in. It's not an enterprise fund, but we operate it sort of like an enterprise fund. We collect this, we set the rates, the money goes into the account, and the expenses come out. And we account for like a part of Kevin's time or any of the highway department time that is used during the wastewater. It pays for the operator's expenses and repairs, that kind of thing. No cost for the town's wastewater treatment operations will be paid for using free cash or general taxation, but will be paid entirely by grants, loans, and fees for service.
Why is there in the warrant for the annual town meeting, number 9, it says, see if the town will vote to raise and appropriate transfer from payable funds or otherwise provide any sums of money, blah, 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 for operation and maintenance of the town's wastewater treatment plants.
That
sewer lines that take any action relative there too. That wording says it can come from general funds. To me, my interpretation of it.
Well, we're taking it out of the wastewater treatment. We're taking it out of the wastewater.
Yeah, it doesn't say that.
That's just the article. The language is defines the scope of the conversation. The motion will say that the town meeting will approve the budget for the department and then authorize the Board of Selectmen as the sewer commissioners to assess fees in order to collect that amount of money. Since when? I don't know. When I was
forever.
Forever. The wastewater operations have been funded entirely through sewer fees.
Was this article not, was there similar language in the warrant?
That's a literal copy from last year.
Okay.
Word for word copy.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Article 10 is funding article for upgrades to the wastewater treatment facility in South Deerfield. The funding for the design planning of these upgrades will come from sewer reserves. Any borrowing from the work will be paid for out of sewer user fees and will result in no additional cost to taxpayers. So.
But
That's the headworks.
No, but that's not what the article says. I don't know what you're reading.
I'm just reading Doug's thing.
This is narrative.
It doesn't say that, though. It doesn't say it.
In order to borrow money, the Board of Selectmen need the approval from town meeting, regardless of the purpose and regardless of how the borrowing is going to be paid for.
But I'm here as a taxpayer voting, as a septic system owner. I'm voting to take general taxation money.
No.
Could be.
No.
Could,
no, no.
No. Could. The language says it
yeah,
could
but
be
I,
taken from
the,
general
we
taxation.
We read the motion. We read the motion. We say it's from.
Instructions at night will be.
Mm-hmm. Huh? When we make the motion.
Instructions at night.
There's nothing that stops somebody from coming out on annual town meeting floor and changing where we appropriate, how we appropriate, because it's a vote of the mass that's there. So. Our motion, as we've presented, has always been the same, that anything that comes with the sewer user, it's got sewer repairs, at this point, for as far back as I can remember, is it comes from the sewer user's funds. At some point in time, if we have to fix the system or expand the system or do something, we're going to have to look for grants, bonds, or other things. At that point in time, the language will be important to have it understood. Where's the money coming from? But it can't happen until the motion is read that tells you exactly where the money needs to come from. That's the way it works.
I understand that, Mark.
Can't
the language say that?
Well,
instead of just making a broad statement.
Because it stops communications. It stops the ability for people on the floor to talk about the subject. If you make it so strict, and if we made the discussion and said, okay, we want to have X, Y, and Z from free cash only, then the article is no longer valid if we don't spend free cash on it. So we give all the options so that the article has the best survival rate for discussion. And then the motion is the way we describe, and you have to actually go back and change the motion before anything can be voted. It's general because we're looking for the community to have input into how we govern. And if we make it so specific that there's no way of generally of discussion, there's...
You can make a motion to change it, right?
Absolutely. No, once you've set up the fundamental of it, the motion can't change the article. The motion can be changed, but the motion can't physically change what the article is. That's my understanding.
Why can't we see the motions?
You can. We'll hand them out.
They're still under legal review, actually. They're with legal counsel.
Can I just make one comment and
sure.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but at this point, the bylaws prevent the town from using anything but sewer funds to repair or maintain the sewer.
That's correct.
But
however, the special town meeting is going to ask the citizens mm-hmm. to repeal that law.
It's not a law; it's a code.
It's a code or a bylaw.
It was a recommendation to the board, to the select board, to take language towards that, so that we had a mindset that the sewer should pay for itself. The instructions to us from the annual town meeting was for us to consider putting something in the bylaws that stated it in that manner. That was not a voted article. It wasn't anything that had any conviction that it had to be done that way. What gave it the conviction is we voted it as a code, and it's in there. The two issues that occur with that is the town and its village center has a benefit by having sewer there, which allows commerce to exist, which we don't compensate for. So some people aren't paying their fair share in the process.
Right. Well, that's the argument, which isn't really. I understand that part of it, that wasn't really my question. My comment was that John's question was that Article 10 in the regular town meeting seemed to indicate that the town could use other sources of funding rather than the sewer. Receipts.
Right.
And in fact, there is a code or a right. bylaw that prevents right. that from being done at this moment.
Right.
However, once the special town meeting repeals that code, then Article 10 in the regular town meeting will allow for general funds to be used in the Am I correct?
Yeah, you're right. Yes, you're correct.
Right.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is, and that's been my concern all along. If the Article 6 passes in the special town meeting that has an impact on Articles 9 and 10 on the wastewater treatment plant in the regular town meeting, and I think that needs to be clear. And as I said before, I think this whole discussion is premature because, you know, we're still in the realm of just starting sewer study, treatment study.
Correct.
And I think this whole thing probably should be put off until that study comes back. We have, as I said before, and I emailed you people, I have 16 questions here related to this whole process that I think is very valid, needs to be addressed before we get to this point. My concern is, and I think everybody in town needs to understand this, that if Article 6 and we change the bylaw, then that means everybody and anybody is open for a user fee charge, a rate, whether you have access to that or not. So even people that will be non-users and do not have access to the sewer system could be charged the same rate, full rate, that a user could be charged. And I know we say, well, let's just work about that after the fact. Well, working on that after the fact puts the non-users in a very difficult position, because now they come to the table with an empty hand. They have nothing to negotiate with. So whatever that rate is determined, they don't have a choice. They pay. And so I think that's why the Article 6 in the special town meeting is very critical, very important. And I think we've got, once again, my personal feeling is, and it's not intentional, it's not anybody's fault, these things need to be addressed. But once again, I think we have the cart before the horse. And that's my feeling. And I know John has some other thoughts on it too, and I respect his thoughts. There's no question about it. But it comes down to, I really hate to see users and non-users pitted against each other. It would be really nice if we could have a discussion about this ahead of time and come up with a mutual solution to this issue. And obviously that's not going to happen, because it's being forced to vote on the town floor in the special town meeting with the Article 6 about wanting to change that bylaw.
But I think it's perfectly legitimate to for your concerns, and if a lot of people share your concerns, then it will be defeated.
Well, I think though, Carolyn, that the citizens as a whole may not be as conversant with the issues as we are, those of us who are involved, and I don't think that the average non-user or septic system user has any idea of how much money it may cost them to, in effect, subsidize the sewer users. And, you know, I don't have an opinion one way or the other, but I think that the citizens ought to know what they're voting for. And I agree with Jeff that Article 6 is really premature. You know, and until the citizens can really make an informed vote. And I'd really like to see Article 6 removed from the special town meeting.
I'd like to chime in.
Okay.
Straw poll. Nobody's holding anybody to anything. Would you agree that Chapter 150, Section 2, if you can read through the strikeouts, would you broadly generally agree that Chapter 150, Article 2 of the bylaws of the town of Deerfield, as written right now, does not prevent the town from seeking grant funds to make repairs and upgrades to the wastewater treatment plant?
I don't know. I don't know what you're asking.
You're saying as far as pursue the grant to apply for it, so it's not just the user.
Or make a borrowing.
And say that in Article 6. Change Article 6 so it says that.
If the town broadly agrees that the Board of Selectmen may borrow to support the wastewater upgrades, improvements, so on and so forth, assuming that Article 6, Chapter 150, Section 2 stays in place, which means that the cost for that borrowing would have to be borne by the sewer users. If that is what everyone broadly agrees, then we can what's the right term? Peter James would kill me if I said the wrong term.
Passover.
Passover is a holiday. Take no action on Article 6.
This was
but Article 10 in the main town meeting still has to go through. If we want to move forward with the repairs that are
Article
essential
6
to the
was a response
system.
To instructions to officers. I mean, this was not coming from
us. I'm sorry.
This Article 6 was response. I mean, was our response to or instructions to officers at the end of the last.
The Article 6 was created by. Instructions to us, but the looking at the language with where we have to move forward with repairs to the sewer treatment facilities, our concern was not
being
what yours is, just being able to borrow money because that money didn't come from the users. It came from a lending institution, and we can't go for grant money because of that aspect of it. The rewording, you can write the rewording any way you want and move to change it. It's important that we move through and make the changes so we can actually continue to stay in pace with getting repairs done to the sewer treatment facility. These are repairs that have been daunting us for a considerable amount of time, and it's got to keep moving on track. And at some point in time, we're going to have a very healthy conversation about where we're going. The sad part about it is this forum is not looking for this, the evolution is not looking for that dialogue, because we don't know where where this quest is going to take us. We don't know if we're going to have expansions of sewers, we're going to have satellite facilities, whether we're going to have, but the head end is the part that is now critical to keeping the system in its present condition and
so,
not.
So you're saying that process is contingent on Article 6?
No. This is just cleaning up the language. It's nothing more than cleaning up the language.
And if
you guys come up with better wording, wordsmithing for this aspect, we'll take
it. I have on number 14 here. Until we establish a master plan and have enough information, why not propose or vote to add language to the existing Chapter 150, Article 2, which will allow for grant monies to be applied to costs? And that way, that leaves that article alone and allows for grant money to be contributed to that fund, to the sewer reserve fund, and it would not impact the users or non-users one way or the other. And to propose something like that, I think, would be more appropriate than to be asking people to butt heads at town meeting. Like I say, we're so premature with this, and I agree with you, Mark, at some point in time, we need that discussion, but I would rather have it after we have a completed sewer study than before, and asking people to make all these radical changes, which could leave everybody open for some huge increases in their tax bills. We're not talking about a small project here. We're not talking about a small expense. We're talking, I've heard numbers of $30 to $32 million. That's huge for the town to take on. I mean, look at what, just for the school roof, what's that adding? And, you know, that was what, $3 million?
What's that adding?
It's not
that adding to the tax rate.
For 1.5 mil, I think it was like about
$140 for the average.
Pardon me?
$140 to the average taxpayer for the school.
Right, and how much for the dollar amount? What's the dollar amount on that school roof that we're paying for that $140?
$3 million.
Pardon?
$3 million.
All right, now I'm paying $30 million.
1.6. It's actually half that. It's 1.6.
Right, 1.5 million. Now times that, great, by $32 million. That's huge. Also,
I have to say, Jeff, that we would not be doing this 100% by ourselves. Okay,
pardon?
We would be looking for grants and stuff like that.
Oh no, I understand that. I agree. There's no question about it, and everybody's for that. But as I said, I think we need to have a completed sewer study before we try to move forward on this. We don't even know, my last question here, as far as, talk about developing 5 and 10. We talked about that before, and townspeople were against it because of the rural characteristic. Also, you have wetland issues there. You have special permitting, I believe. And with that said, town Deerfield has several existing locations for businesses that are basically shovel-ready but are not attracting any attention, which leads to the last two questions I have out of 14. Does the added value of extending the existing sewer line justify the cost? And then the other one, why not just upgrade the existing wastewater treatment plants to the required standards, state standards, and not incur the cost of extending the sewer line? Also, less maintenance. And I don't think we can answer that until we have that sewer study back.
You're absolutely correct. We do not have enough information to even consider those things at this point.
So I don't understand why we're asking to change this at the town meeting now.
This is a response for instructions to officers, and we can pass this over.
Just one other comment for food for thought, and correct me if I'm wrong. I would assume that every resident in the town of Deerfield owns every town building. Would that be a true statement?
No. The town is a corporation. The corporation owns town property.
Okay.
But we have an interest. Each resident has an interest in the public buildings.
Pardon?
Each resident has an interest in the public buildings.
Each resident has an interest, okay.
Right.
In which case, each resident furnishes all town budgets, including operations of every town building. In that sense, every resident in the town of Deerfield becomes a user of the system because every town building is tied in with that system. Now, the town of Deerfield, and correct me if I'm wrong on this one, has not transferred funds into the wastewater treatment plant for any town building ever since this bylaw was done. So the town, in all reality, and its residents, owns at least tens of thousands of dollars, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars, towards a wastewater treatment plant fund. And I don't want to get into discussion. This is just a point for thought.
It's as valid a point as what Jeff
was
talking
about. That's an interesting comment. And I think this is the kind of discussion that our town should have about this issue.
Well,
you know,
let me ask
you
a question.
Rather than just presenting citizens with this article, which means to me, I've thought about this, and I don't know what the ramifications of it are, and I don't think the average person who's going to come to town meeting is going to really know what they're voting on. That's my whole point. And that's why I agree with Jeff that it's premature.
And that's why food for thought. Interest falls away.
Yeah.
I agree that it is a premature article.
I think there's a lot of agreement in the room because discussions I've had with John before and the point that Bruce brought up, there's definitely some value there for everybody in town. I'm not arguing that whatsoever. All I'm saying is what is that value compared to users and non-users? And it would be nice if we could come up with that answer. I guess that's the question.
That answer doesn't have anything to do with Article 6. I mean, we've gone way. Yes, I can give you scenarios that will take us out to the 100th mile mark and start talking about it. But the reality of it is that wasn't the intention, and it isn't the intention. And it's one of those things that we'll go back and thank you very much for the input. We'll go back and consider where we're at. And Jeff, you have to understand one thing. You have your opinion, and you're very strong about your opinion, and you've talked to all the people about your opinion that's probably sitting in this room, and we know that it's there. The reality is you can't say more than I can say that we speak for the townspeople.
Oh, I'm not saying I speak for the townspeople.
To actually take and recommend that you can rewrite an article or rewrite based upon your own knowledge and skills is the same thought process you're asking us to consider for why you don't want us to put it up in place. We're looking at a functional document and upgrading it. We will take it under consideration and look at what it means, and we'll either modify it or take no action.
Mark, I think the select board does direct or lead the conversation.
We hope so.
And when the select board puts an article on the warrant,
mm-hmm.
I don't know how to say this, but it
just blurted
you
out.
You almost endorse it because this is your your plan.
This was not generated by us, though.
Okay,
the thing is, there are some articles that we have no choice in.
So that ought to be explained that it's coming from the sewer commissioners, the select board.
No.
Maybe.
The thing is, its origin, and not to get off to skew, but its origin is
my
not...
Only, My only point is that you direct the conversation, or you
Correct.
Lead the conversation.
Correct.
So you do have an effect on the ultimate outcome,
Correct.
Because you're leading the conversation. So it's not like you're just neutral when you.
No, I'm just saying
you
that
present an article. Any of these articles.
And all of these articles are vetted through departments, department heads, people who work with this day in and day out. This is their, you know, this is their bailiwick. It goes through our administrative corps. It goes to our legal corps. It goes through everybody before we put that out there for consideration. But this is what the problem I'm having is, this is what it should be, is this type of conversation as to the validity of, and the fears and the realities and the reasons why we're doing it. We'll have, from this conversation, we'll have better information for why, and I'm sure that Jeff will have better information as to why not, and we'll go for that way for it. That's why this forum is so valuable, is the fact that we're doing it. But we're taking your information, I hope you're taking the information we're offering back. We'll polish it, and we may take no action on it, or we may, as the motion is allowed to do, express the reasons why it's important at this point in time, in this juncture, for us to do that. I'm not prepared to give you that information because you've given us a lot of good information. Jeff just handed those questions to us basically 4 days ago.
Correct.
And a lot of the questions he has, I've already contemplated and thought about, but the discussion we're coming from is the repair and continuous use of a facility that supports Deerfield in many ways, mm-hmm. and it hasn't been considered as supporting it in many ways. And fair and equitable is something else we should be having the conversation about. So,
well, the septic, there's going to be a lot of resentment from people with septic systems whose thought process is going to be, you know, if my septic system fails, I got to come up with $20,000, and the town of Deerfield is not going to help me. So why should we? And I'm just.
It's a valid consideration.
Actually, finish that question. So why should we? What's the end of that question?
The end of the question is there needs to be a wider discussion than 15 minutes on the floor of the town meeting. There needs to be a wider discussion. This is my whole point, that there needs to be a wider discussion so that the ultimately the correct decision is made by the whole town.
Including those who
really aren't going to benefit from paying for
has anyone proposed that non-sewer users pay for expenses related to the wastewater system? That's not what the article says.
It could.
All right, guys. Well,
anybody got anything new they'd like to?
I think a lot of people think that.
I think that people think it because they're being told that. The reality of it is, it's just wording smithing in the process. And be honest, it's not worth the amount of time that we put in here, premature or not premature. It's easy to pass it. It's easy to.
Take no action on it.
I just wanted to bring up another point. When I was listening to the Finance Committee meeting, I think Mr. Pachurik had mentioned that the way our sewer system is set up attracts businesses to our town. And that because of having businesses in our town, doesn't that ultimately lower the tax rate of even the non-users of the sewer system? So, I mean, I just want, when you're looking at it, to look at the whole picture. Because down the road, maybe the non-users will pay, bless you, pay a flat fee of sorts, and maybe your sewer users actively, you know, that actively use the sewer system could use another rate. But to me, if the town benefits by having businesses come to town because of our sewer system, then that does benefit the whole town if it lowers our taxes.
Right, and that's
Brian,
that's a very powerful argument that somebody needs to make to the entire town.
We have discussed that earlier, and that's why we've said that there is some value to that. And you're right on, John. John mentioned that before, and I agree with John that there is value to that. I also want to remind people, too, that a lot of businesses came because of our low taxes, not just the sewer, but also because of our low taxes, and also we have a single tax rate instead of a split tax rate. So there's many factors that come into play with it.
And
unfortunately, Bruce, it is strictly a user fee, then you're going to double the taxes on the businesses.
Right, and that's why I say there's some value there.
Well, you have to stay away from there.
Right, there's some value.
I think you have committee members to research this subject sitting in the audience.
Maybe there should be an article saying we need a commission created to study this.
And that's what you do on town meeting floors. Say clearly that there's not enough discussion on this, so we should pass it. You know, not pass it. Take no action.
No, I think that.
Just a quick follow-up to the question you asked to answer me the question. If there was a rebate to somebody had to put a $20,000 septic system in over a period of time on their taxes, it would make sense that everybody would be getting some benefit. If the townwide was taxed for the sewer, the non-sewer users, they had to put a septic system in, they would get a deduction over a 10 or 20 year period on their taxes based on the amount they paid. Everybody's equal.
There have been many
Stop up.
I know. I was just thinking regulations.
There have been many. There have been many efforts to do that, even with state incentive money.
Yep.
About 20 years ago, they offered up money to actually put money aside so that we could fund, because it's vitally important that people who have septic systems take care of them, because that doesn't pollute the water and all that other stuff. So the state realized that, and there has been programs out there, and the town can look at those type of programs.
I read both of those programs.
And the last part, this one article is taking way too much time in the process. We're not going to get there.
But no, that's really good that it's a lot of questions. Yeah, there's a lot of questions.
The last thing is that we really need to have a committee. If they really feel that there's that type of information, I feel good because I came in and sat through the presentations by the engineering corps and that group, and I go to Boston and I go through all of the different types of facilities that are available and changes that are available. I look at it, I'm familiar with it. And that information to come down to have conversation with is extremely hard because it's so technical and so diverse. A committee of half of this room and half of that side of the room come together and actually talk about these without killing one another would be very valuable to the town of Deerfield, because then you could talk as a citizen advocate group to fix the problem. So we have a sign-up sheet for anybody who wants to be assigned to a committee for sewer evaluation for the town. Get your name here and we'll start running one up. I'm sure that our engineering corps will gladly help us get all the baseline information we need in place, and we'll move forward with it. I don't have a problem, but I got to have at least five people to institute the committee.
Okay, I volunteer.
Get your names to Doug.
Okay, and I didn't even know it was there.
We'll work that out.
And we'll just make a formal motion to take action.
Just one other comment on the tax. Everybody's property in town is broken down into neighborhoods. The people in the center of town that are on sewer are in different neighborhoods. They already do pay a higher real estate tax. Their values are higher on their land in the center of town that are on sewer already. So there is a difference there already as far as, you know, if you look at a base building lot, it will vary in the neighborhoods. There is a multiplier is put on in the center of town for different neighborhoods in town because of access to sewer, closest to fire, and so forth. So it's not just, you know, using John's house. If his house was identical to mine, his would be taxed less, okay, automatically. Right. So there is that difference still.
I really need to get a handle on this and move it into committee.
Valued less.
I just have a
You had to do this to Mary, didn't you? I could tell everybody else, but I can't tell you no. Go ahead.
Last comment that I'm going to have. You're answering the instructions from the town meeting. I thought we answered that basically by spending $10,000 for a study, not to come back with an article to defeat the article that was already in the works, you know, the bylaw.
The sewer rate study is proceeding forward. The advice we've gotten from our consultant has suggested a number of different things, including changing the way we, in providing recommendations. I'm sorry, he's not suggesting anything specifically. They're providing recommendations with the way we assess sewer, the fees. They're providing recommendations. They're going to be providing a couple of different models in terms of how sewer fees are assessed based on a user, a residence, an institution, a business, so on and so forth. They're looking at our sewer fees in terms of the context between this community and other communities of this size. And they're looking overall at the infrastructure of the plants, the infrastructure of the system. They're looking at the age of the system. They're looking at the improvements that have been done to the system, which took very little time. Because there was very little done. And they're also looking at the system as it stands right now in terms of the amount of labor it takes and the danger that it puts the operators in to maintain this system. That's where the headworks design first came into being, is to allow the system to operate without having our guys go out on a little floating platform out into the middle of the one of these ponds, dressed in the full Tyvek suits and the gloves and the mask and all that, and literally take razor blades on the end of long sticks and cut away the bundles and bundles and bundles of dental floss that have wrapped themselves around the impellers and that are doubling the electric bill at the plant.
Those flushables.
They do that about once every month, 2 months.
Again, that
they take away truckloads of this stuff.
All right.
This
all right.
is, and I'm getting into too much detail, and I apologize.
No, it's good. It's really probably a good time to make one final statement. Pardon?
Shut up.
No, don't you need to shut up. It's good. One last thing, just since we delved into that really messy part of this thing. Anybody that can understand the process, our facility doesn't have anything that takes any of the flushable things, anything above a toilet paper type of thing, the
T-shirts.
T-shirts are definitely out, but you know, any of the Depends, any of the other stuff that basically is not really designed to go into a sewer treatment facility. Our facility is so old, we weren't even designed to handle that stuff. So anything that is a wipe, you know, the pull it out of the bag wipe type of things, paper, towels, that kind of stuff just plays havoc. And basically that's the reason we're out right now, is we're wearing out our equipment because this stuff is very damaging to our equipment and how it works. And as Carolyn said, it drives up our electric bill in the same process because you can't do it.
I don't think anybody is questioning the $1.4 million that needs to be spent on the headworks. It's just how it's going to be funded.
Well, just stop flushing stuff. I didn't say that and didn't mean to have anybody take from that it had anything to do with the headworks proposal.
Well, I still think the town needs a public relations campaign to educate people that they shouldn't be doing
this. Oh, we've tried everything.
Speaking of Jane Trujillo, she'll be happy to help us.
Yeah. Oh,
well,
my God.
We'll see what you can do with the committee. I mean, you have to understand that
we're going to use that camera.
You're always going to have two camps.
I voted for the headworks.
Okay, next.
Okay. Well, clearly there's more discussion, and we have some volunteers tonight, so that's fantastic, so we can have an in-depth conversation, because I think that's what, if everyone is able to talk about it and you come up with a solution, I think we can come up with a solution if we work together, and we'll be able to address it. So I'm really excited about that. Make sure Doug gets all your names, because it might take a few meetings, but it would be so worth it, because then we can have a really good discussion. We can come up with a really fair solution, and and we can move ahead, because that does have to be addressed and keep our costs down as well. Article 11 is the funding article for South County EMS. This request is a reduction of $73,000 from FY16. Mark, do you want to say anything on that?
The article where it says it's $314,307 is the fact that we approve all of the budget for South County EMS, and that's the reduction that's across all of the towns. The numbers with what Carolyn just said, which is $73,000, is skirted because of the administrative cost processes. So basically, there's more money coming out of this budget than there was because they didn't pay out two years in the past.
Your handout says that 16 was the same amount.
That's a typo. I apologize.
It should be $387,990.
Oh, Zach, I didn't even realize you're here.
Well, I thought I wasn't relevant for the sewer conversation. So.
Not really. We can rope you in. Don't worry.
So if anyone has a question, Zach's right here.
Shoot, you're right.
I'm sorry. You were blocked. Does anyone have a question?
Yeah, what number was that, Zach?
The FY16 appropriation was $387,990.
Yep.
That's correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Capital requests are one-time purchases for planned maintenance and repair of town assets, as well as purchase of new equipment that is expected to stay in service for at least 3 years. What we did this year, we had a Ford 550 with a dump body. It replaces a vehicle that's about 8 years old. There's a new John Deere tractor, which will replace the current tractor that is about 25 years old. There is 11 automatic defibrillator units that are placed in police cars and at municipal buildings that have essentially reached the end of their life. The batteries and compatible with our ambulance and stuff like that, so it's important to have them replaced. The new units will be the units that are compatible with South County EMS. And then finally, a photocopier used by staff and residents at the Tilton Library that provides users with convenience and the library with a modest revenue resource is going to be replaced. This total capital request is $174,599. John, would you like to address what we didn't do, or just
No,
give a few more questions?
That's not why I raised my hand.
Oh, okay.
Unless anybody has any questions about them. Stated each one of these in the article itself. Why didn't that happen this year?
Why didn't we put them in the warrant article?
You mean in the warrant article?
Yeah.
No, the schedule is just not listed. They'll be listed in the motion.
Why? Oh, is there?
Why not?
There are a number of...
A lot of people are wondering, is something trying to be hidden? People I've talked to.
Really? It's in the motion. Peter was talking about their handouts. We probably should not have as many handouts at town meeting. His email today. He wanted to clean that up.
But we're not. I don't think we're going to.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know why you can't hear. It seems like I'm talking fairly loud.
The expectation is that at town meeting there's going to be a packet of information that will include this, the capital schedule. This, which is the dollar items from the special town meeting, which happens prior to it, plus a number of handouts with narratives that explain a number of the different articles. Some of those handouts will also include some of the change, the recommended change to the zoning bylaw, for example, a number of other things. The expectation is that we're going to be able to put that into essentially a booklet, which will be available to every town meeting member when they arrive to look at.
So the schedule will be printed out then, Doug?
The schedule will be printed out.
One thing that we've done in the past is try to limit this document because of the size and girth of it, and we pass out. In the past, we've.
I apologize.
Trying to. I didn't do it.
I apologize that we are not loud enough.
In the past, this document, the warrant articles, have been tried to keep small because of the cost of the production of them. And we've left the motions control the actual verbiage, and they're always handed out, and they're always available before we go into annual town meeting. The Peter James has recommended that we scale that back. We're not sure if we could do that at this point because of where we are in the legal reviews of the process and the dates, but he's going to work with Doug tomorrow. It was one of the subjects that he thought was that needed to be cleaned up, and it was something he thought was an oversight on his behalf. This probably is only one in 37 years, but for a phenomenal job that he's done here. So we'll look at that. But I can assure you that all the information will be readily available and at annual town meeting.
Would it be appropriate to ask at the town meeting if people find that excessive amount of paperwork helpful or not helpful? And maybe instead of putting the pressure on you guys to decide, that you could show a vote of hands, you know?
We've, about 15 years ago, that's why we went to the smaller documents. So it was by show of hands. So if people want us to go back to bigger documents, we can do that. And again, we're trying to curb some of the costs. So we agree with some of it, and some of it we don't want to short circuit. Like whenever we do a change to bylaws and stuff, it's the verbiage is completely in there, and the text is made so that it's not changed. So we'll work on that.
Do we have a copy of the 5-year proposed capital plans? We'll have some idea of what's coming down the road, what we can discuss with the capital committee and so forth.
Well, actually, what we're going to do is John has scheduled a May 25th capital meeting, and we're going to put together our plan because plan we have is not.
There's supposed to be one now.
There isn't.
By the bylaws, there's supposed to be one now.
There isn't.
The selectmen are supposed to hold a public meeting, in which case that would bring in some of these other controversial items that are being have been discussed. And it's in black and white, and it should be a published meeting by the Board of Selectmen with the present capital plan and the proposed 4 years, continuing 4 years.
We felt that the 5-year plan that we had was not adequate, and so we're going to relook at everything.
So, in other words, you're ignoring the bylaws for this year.
Well, we can bring forward the one we had last year, but it's we felt it was not meaningful. I don't know, John. How do you feel? I mean, we can just print it out.
I didn't even know there was one. I mean, this is my first year as chairperson, so.
And, we've always had a 5-year plan, and it's gone out to 10 years, depending on how big the pieces of equipment
Kevin,
we have.
And Kevin presented us with a 15-year plan, but But we felt that it was not adequate, and there was too much unknown information on the sewer treatment situation, the wastewater treatment plant. So that's why we have the meeting on the 25th, and we're going to revamp everything. And it certainly will be public what we come up with in the, you know, after our May and
that's going to take time.
Yeah, it's going to take time. We wanted to be thoughtful, Bruce, and the one we had from last year, we can certainly reprint it if you want, but it with all the information from the sewer treatment plant information that we have now, and no decisions have been made, I mean, that's one of the things that is impacting this.
Doug, can you take an item to make sure we look at what Bruce is saying as a required meeting so that we don't miss the meeting? The plan doesn't have to be...
updated.
It doesn't. We have to present what we have. It doesn't have to be something that's beyond the scope of the people who are doing the work. We'd like to have a more inclusive document, and it would probably be the time in which we could start adding things to that to that plan from the public hearing if it's a requirement that we have one. So would you look into seeing if we're supposed to have a public meeting and what its format is so that we can make sure we address it as appropriately?
We can just run that the plan that we have from last year, Bruce.
Which is fine, but I think it's very important. You know, all these there's millions of dollars facing the town of Deerfield in the next few years. And I think it's very important for a lot of the monetary decisions that are going to be made is people understand that, you know, we may be needed $1 million for this year, $5 million for the next year. Three. I don't care whether it's all, you know, not down to the numbers. Your budgets are not down to the numbers. They're only guesstimates. Well, the five-year plan is also a guesstimate. Anything can happen in between. Understand it. But people need to be aware of not necessarily the numbers, but what is going to be needed in this town in the next 4 to 5 years.
And that's why John had scheduled the May 25th meeting, because the plan that we had did not include the $3 million roof that just emerged this year. It had roof line item, and it had us put away $200,000 or something, but it certainly didn't have a $3 million roof included, and it certainly didn't have anywhere near $30 million worth of repair work to the wastewater treatment facility. So,
but we don't have the sky. We don't have that information.
So we didn't have that information. We felt it was not a valid five-year plan anyway. So we were going to start working on it, and John scheduled a meeting a few weeks ago. So it's on the schedule to work on it, and we certainly can bring forward what we have. But the wastewater treatment stuff is not, the numbers are just too hard to wrap around our mind around at this moment, and we don't know. I mean, I was pursuing a HUD grant for $20 million. We didn't get it. But we're looking into other grant opportunities. So the $32 million, to put $32 million there looks is so distorting. We don't expect the town to be paying that. No. Is it out there? Maybe. I'm not even convinced that that's a real number, to tell you the truth.
There again, this is supposedly a four-year plan. We know that's not going to happen within 4 years, so it wouldn't be part of the four-year plan anyway.
What? Again, what's not part of the four-year plan?
Well, wastewater treatment at this point.
$32 million allotment.
Yeah, no, that's right. Not a four-year plan.
So that wouldn't be incorporated. But,
I don't think that was ever suggested to be a four-year plan or a five-year plan.
No, I'm talking about.
Oh, he's talking about the actual.
The capital
improvement.
I understand.
So let's just look and make sure that if there's something out there in the bylaw that we're required to hold a separate meeting that discusses this issue. To be honest with you, I think we're meeting the
our intention was
the
meet
intention.
The spirit of it.
We're meeting the intention with what we have in knowledge and skill at this point in time, understanding that we didn't have the school roof on our radar correctly. We didn't have, and we should have known many years ago, that we should have been doing some planning on the wastewater treatment facility. We got sidewalks, we've got other things that we're looking at that need to get into this plan, and they're going to do very set up to do a great job of looking at that and try to get their arms around it. And we'll meet our obligations to have a meeting if necessary, but I think we've got pretty much a good handle on what we knew. It's what we didn't know that's going to come forward now. And thanks the committee for doing the work that they do.
Article 14 is the article for the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. The assessment is $42,750. Which is a little bit, was, oh.
That
Might be an error. Take a look at the screen for that assessment.
You know what? That's all right. I'll look
that
it up here.
That number is correct.
The 16 was 42,750. This year is $43,701, so it went up slightly. And the increase basically was related to, they made a lot of cuts to cover the cost of insurance went up. Their cost of drugs were through the Hampshire Trust as well. So that cost was the main increase. It wasn't anything else. They actually reduced other items. So the increase is modest. Article 15 is funding for educational expenses for students attending Smith Vocational. And that is severely reduced because the number of students has been reduced. Doug, is it, it went down from 3 to 1 or something like
it
that?
It went from 3 students to 1, yes.
Okay.
So this is a significant reduction.
And obviously the transportation has been reduced as well.
Just a little bit.
A little bit. Article 16 is a reserve for unfunded vacation and sick leave in the amount of $10,000, which is a reserve set aside every year to pay for a retiring employee's vacation and sick time in keeping with the requirements of the personnel bylaw. That account got pretty much cleaned out with retirements in the last few years, so we're continuing to fund that for the future. Article 17 provides a reserve for $80,000 for the Finance Committee for unexpected expenses. If something happens, you know, a transmission goes somewhere that's not budgeted or whatever, then they can go to the Finance Committee for that.
How much is in there now?
How much have we expended to date, Doug?
In the reserve fund?
Yeah. Yes. How much in the Finance Committee
approved? Roughly speaking, $29,000. About $25,000 for the traffic loop at the elementary school, and roughly $3,000 to $4,000, which was to cover a cost or a funding shortage on the school.
So it's pretty earmarked. There's no surplus, so to speak.
Oh, no. What happens if we don't spend it? It goes back into free cash.
They've got about, and the biggest thing is it's supposed to come in the last 2 or 3 months of the year. We've already tapped into it a little bit early, but there's about $50,000 left in the account.
Okay, thank you.
The traffic loop at the elementary school, everyone agreed to pay for it by the Finance Committee's reserve fund, and that was a totally unexpected expense. So people felt comfortable with that, and we hadn't really had too many other expenses. Article 18 is the annual funding for the assessor's recertification process. That's going to be go to if the governor has a bill to extend that out to 5 years, but that if we still have to fund it this year because it's too late for our budgeting process this year. So that should be reduced a little bit in the future because we won't have to do it every 3 years. We'll be able to get by with every 5 years. Article 19 is $10,000 for reserve for the other post-retirement benefits, OPEB. And actually, the Finance Committee has zero recommendation. And I don't know, as a Select Board, we haven't had a chance to talk about it, but I would, you know, we have well over $1 million. It doesn't matter whether whatever you say is our liability is going to be at least $1 million. But we have no plan, and you know, there's not really any good practices out there yet. So I feel comfortable if we don't fund it for another year.
We had the opportunity Saturday to ask Governor Weld. He said, "Don't worry about it."
You mean Baker?
Governor Baker?
Or Baker, yeah.
Yeah, I think Governor Well doesn't care where he's at.
But anyway, it's way down on his list of things that he theory.
Yeah, well, there's when we get the when we get a number in the next year from our accountants, and we are required to pay for them to come up with a number by state requirements, then we will get the number, which will be over $1 million, I'm sure, but then we will sit down and try to figure out what other towns are doing, and we'll worry about it then, because $10,000 one way or the other is not going to make any difference. So we'll just I'm comfortable with the Finance Committee's recommendation. I don't know about you, Mark. Are you?
I'm not. I honestly feel that basically we realize we have an unfunded mandate. Whether Carolyn's even close to the mark one way or the other, I don't really know. And the governor is smart by saying don't worry about it because he doesn't know either.
Right.
But we know there's going to be a liability. We know that we put together, and Carolyn's illusion that we don't have a plan, we do. And this is where we actually do what Jeff's asking us to do, is we start slow and move through the process. We put a fund together so that
he
we can put
money
into it. No, I was talking about his sewer plan, not about this one. We're not going to win. Jeff's going to be on the opposite side of whatever we say, but that's okay. That's what keeps us honest.
Mark, let me correct you. I built my whole career, and I'm serious about this, I built my whole career on compromise, and I have a very open mind. Do I have strong opinions? I most certainly do. But I also am very open-minded, and I listen to what the other side of the table has to say.
You didn't hear what I said.
We'll let town meeting decide what they want to do, because obviously we're split here.
But the reality is we've set up a fund to do it, and I think that in all fairness, to put some money in there as a seed money, and I recommended a much higher number. And it's not going to touch anything, as Carolyn said. It's not going to make the big difference. But it shows the good faith that we're concerned about it and we're going to continue to monitor and follow it. It's no more than putting money into a small savings account that will be used for that at a period. I don't highly recommend that we fund any large sums because then it gets tied up in that thought process. And if the government comes through and wins out or hands out big gobs of money, then we have $10,000 that we can't account for. But I think it's in good faith that we do it. And again, we'll chase that to ground later on.
Article 20 provides $10,000 to support Montague's participation in the DPU gas moratorium hearings. We appropriated $8,500 last year to go to the FERCOG, and I went to meetings and stuff, since last year, it's really, there's nothing we can do to mitigate what's going to happen. They're just going to run over us. So we did not spend that money or did not use it towards the FERCOG's mitigation efforts, and we are. Or at least my position has been much more, let's fight this. And so we're taking that money that we didn't spend last year and adding $1,500 to, because Montague and Deerfield were eligible to be interveners in this the DPU hearings for Berkshire Gas contract with the NED pipeline. However, our lawyer, Christopher Boniface, doesn't want us to participate in the intervention because then we, as Board of Health members, could be subpoenaed and it would affect our Board of Health cease and desist order that we have in town already. So Montague went by themselves on sort of with the understanding that they would get help. And they intervened, and their average I was only able to get the bills through the end of March because obviously it's not the end of April yet. But they are averaging about $9,300 a month for attorney's fees. That is not the expert witness fee, which is a little over $20,000 at this point. The funds Montague allocated $15,000 in 2016 for the fight. Gill and Northfield each have appropriated $5,000 that they had special town meetings and appropriated for this current year. And Montague has raised approximately $3,600 in fundraising campaign by individuals and businesses to defray some of that cost. At this point, Conway on for fiscal 17 on town meeting warrants, Conway has $5,000 appropriation, Leverett has $5,000, Warwick has $3,000, Wendell has $2,500, and Ashfield has $15,000 for appropriating for the $15,000. Well, their stance 100% was fighting the pipeline from the beginning. They didn't want to do any mitigation efforts through the FERCOC. So it looks like this is going to go on for a little bit. It depends on how much cross-examining there is. This will continue on May 4th. Montague's for this fiscal 17 is appropriating additional $50,000 themselves for this fight. And what's critical here is that the reason why this is important is because these contracts is the need for the pipeline. And one of the reasons that the pipeline was downsized, they're at the Kinder Morgan's application still says up to 42 inches on their application to FERC, but they downsized it to 30 inches so that because they couldn't get any contracts. So questioning the contracts, Berkshire Gas's contracts, and which the expert witness, as you saw in the newspaper today, has found a significant enough information to say that I wouldn't say it's fraudulent yet, but it's very close to not a real case for the contract. So hopefully this will get resolved, and then FERC will not approve of the pipeline because that's one of the basis for approval is need. So one of the other things that's popped up is Kinder Morgan, which is very interesting, is asking the DPU to rule that our Board of Health order is invalid due to preemption by state and federal law, even though legally it has to be done in court. So it's quite interesting they snuck that in a request to DPU. But our stance, our lawyer stance, is the Board of Health order is valid and it has force of law. And they have to take us to court, and they Kinder Morgan gave up their right of appeal based on the fact that they didn't challenge our public hearing process. So, you know, things are happening. There's, you know, a lot of activity on the pipeline, fighting the pipeline. But this intervention thing is very important. So, obviously, since it was not recommended by the Finance Committee, they took no action on it. It will be decided on town meeting floor. But I think it's very important for people to understand that the contract, questioning the contract, is really important. And it is a huge financial commitment on Montague's part for the whole entire county. So that's why other towns are supporting this as well. Is there any questions on it? Probably are all sick of mosquitoes and pipeline issues.
No, but I think it is a good point that the $10,000 isn't to help the town of Montague. It's to also help the town of Deerfield to oppose Kinder Morgan. So,
well, it's to show that the moratorium was falsely imposed. So it will obviously raise the get rid of the moratorium. But also, it would show that there's no need for the pipeline, and that's huge. And the thing that's really critical here is I know people aren't as upset about the pipeline as they were when we had the compressor station, but on the average, when they first permit the pipeline, there is 40 miles or so between the compressor stations. It's a simple permit. Within a month process, you can have another permitted compressor station. And once the pipeline is built, how you make money is you push gas through. And if you look at all the existing pipelines, the average compressor station is about 12 miles apart. So Deerfield is still in the bullseye for a compressor station. And I have to say that after having the mini sink group come down and talk about Minisink, New York, was a compressor station, 12,000 horsepower compressor station, which is very small compared to the ones they're talking about here. And it can be any size. Kinder Morgan can just put in any size, but the Minisink one in New York was 12,000 horsepower. And the health effects that people experienced were extreme, and it really was devastating to the community. And they couldn't do it in Pennsylvania because there was so much stuff from the fracking in the air already, and they were able to do the baseline in Minisink because there was no compressor station there. And so when one was put in, they had a baseline comparison. If you average it over the month, what do you hear? It documented.
Your mic's not working.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's on FCAT. The whole health effects from Minisink. But if the pipeline goes through, it's the other side of this transmission lines from my house. So it's over Welcome's property, just right on the Greenfield border. If you put the compressor station on the property that's on borders Shelburne and Deerfield, which is one of the sites they're considering, or Woman Hill, everybody in the entire town is downwind. So that's a very serious, serious thing to happen to our town. So anyway, if there's no questions, that's okay. But I have plenty of information if anyone wants some. Article 21 is $11,000 to support mosquito trapping, testing, and abatement. We have been trying. Dick Kalaszewski and I went to a meeting about 3 years ago on mosquitoes with the Department of Public Health put on, and mosquito control is really controlled by the Department of Agriculture, so it was the state vet that did the presentation. She's excellent. She's really well informed. And when a group of us were sitting together, we decided we would try to pursue a mosquito district for the entire Pioneer Valley. There is legislation on the books for Franklin County, but it doesn't really make sense because the mosquitoes aren't coming from the hill towns. And the problem with mosquito control districts is the money comes off your cherry sheet before you get your funding from the state. So it's limited control. And so to try to get people to work together is difficult. And we had tried for 3 years to do this Pioneer Valley mosquito control district through the state, and they kept really blowing us off. So what we did as a group, and I'm talking about West Springfield up to Greenfield, investigated different contractors and who does this kind of stuff, and we came up with this group, Vector Disease Control International, and we really liked them, so we decided that we would work together and come up with a pricing. By working together, they would dedicate a person out here to do the trapping, and they would actually coordinate with Dr. Rich at the UMass State Lab to do the testing. That's where we get our ticks tested now. And because of that, the price is about $11,000 to do assessment of us as a community and then to do trapping. The reason why we don't want to spend more than $11,000 at this point. We don't know how bad the Zika virus is going to be. It changes weekly. Yesterday, when we had our Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition meeting, the new map had just come out. And originally, we were told about a month ago that it wasn't until 2020 that the mosquito would be here. And then it was downgraded to 2018. And yesterday they came out and said the mosquito is going to go up to Vermont this summer. So basically, you know, the scenario gets worse. The kind of diseases or impacts are getting worse. The immune system kind of diseases. Who's affected? How long are you affected? Is, you know, getting worse. So we don't know at the money, leftover money from Ebola. It's a little over $500 million is being committed to the CDC to fight mosquitoes. The CDC just signed a contract with the same contractors that we're doing with, so they might be like certified contractors. We're not sure how that money's coming down right now. The president has asked for $2 billion more. We're not sure how that's coming out. So at this point, Northampton and Amherst and West Springfield have already signed on with vector control and Vector Disease Control International. So chances are we're just going to go forward with this, and then, but we're staying flexible in the sense that maybe the only way, if this turns out to be very serious, we might still have to form a mosquito control district if we're going to get reimbursed through the federal government. So we're going with the original plan of $11,000 to get started, and then we're going to be flexible. That's all I can say. Yes, Diane.
You said Northampton and Amherst are already doing this?
What happened is last year, they were concerned about Triple E, which is my concern too. So they had got some money together to do trapping last year, and some of the mosquitoes they trapped came up with Triple E. So in their budget for this year, they appropriated money already to do mosquito control in 16. So the rest of us are doing it for starting in fiscal 17.
Well, it's just a matter of, I mean, you know, I know people from Deerfield work in Amherst, and I go to Greenfield. So if surrounding towns are doing it, and if they had mosquitoes, wouldn't we assume that we had mosquitoes? I'm just wondering why we have to do it if everyone around us is already doing it.
Because mosquitoes generally don't fly much more than half a mile.
But we as people go to those areas. And if we bring it back, and if depending on how it's contracted and the whole thing.
Oh, you're talking about Zika. We're just talking
even,
about.
I mean, what are you talking about?
I'm talking about testing the mosquitoes, because you have to do, when they do trappings, they're checking out what kind of mosquitoes you have, because there's several different varieties, and also what kind of diseases they're carrying. And West Nile, they is up in the old Deerfield area already. Based on the trapping from last summer that happened in Greenfield, you know, right at Cheapside Bridge. So obviously we need to find out if it's still circulating there. Tripoli is in different areas already, so.
But if you said the money from the Ebola virus or whatever is now being transferred, why are the towns having to come up with this?
Because it's not available. It's not available to us, Diane. And this was something that we've been working on for 3 years.
And
the Zika virus, nobody knows to what extent the Zika virus is going to explode at this point. The information changes daily, but. We don't need to panic at this point, because majority of people don't have, you know, any kind of symptoms or have any kind of issues. It's pregnant women, and there's enough stuff going to be happening that once the mosquito season starts, we'll know exactly what's going on statewide, I'm sure. Mary.
Once we find out what kind of mosquitoes we have, what are we going to do about it?
Then we have to decide what would be the action. You know, larvicide is what probably at this point we would do. If the Zika virus turns out to be really a big deal and they're going to have to do spraying, we're going to have public meetings on it, and we'll do all kinds of stuff, and there'll be a lot of stuff in the news. But right now, we do larviciding in our catch basins, and we throw out a few discs here and there. You know, the highway guys, when they're out there, they do it. But what we need to do is to have a more, you know, planned attack, because it's just not enough. There's just a wicked lot of mosquitoes, and they are carrying stuff, and we need to know what is in the... If we are doing trappings on a regular basis, and we are coming up with West Nile, we can say, as a Board of Health, you know, you need to make sure you spray your kids down with DEET. And, you know, we'll give some information out, like you put your sunscreen on first, then you put DEET on, and, you know, we'll talk about how to build a trap and all that kind of stuff yourself so you can get them out of your yard. But if the Zika virus comes and it's a bad thing, then yes, they'll be spraying and stuff, but there'll be all kinds of publicity out there, and we'll have meetings and stuff. So at this point, we are not planning to do anything besides larvaciding if it's recommended. But it would be still part of the conversation, and no, it's not part of the budget, but it is also not something that we haven't been already funding.
All this money covers is trapping and analyzing mosquitoes. That's
And assessment as to where to do the trapping.
So it, at that point, once it goes beyond that, then we'll have to have public hearing. Yeah. Public hearings is going to be all over TV. You're going to hear what's going to happen well before we're even can bring.
And that's where I'm assuming the money is going to come down. But since the CDC has already contracted with the people that we were going to hire anyway, they might be certified, recommended contractors or whatever. So we might not have to do this mosquito control district. We might have to do a mosquito control district, because that's how we get money to fight the Zika if it's really bad. Who knows? I mean, we're just trying to be flexible at this point. But we should do some testing. We should have an assessment of town to where we should be testing and trapping. And we'll do things through the UMass lab, so we'll get a lot more identification of mosquitoes and analyzation for cheaper than if we send it down to Boston to be analyzed.
It would be more timely.
And the turnaround is like 2 or 3 days versus a week in Boston. One of the things is the Boston lab is doing New Hampshire testing as well for the Zika virus, because apparently, I guess, New Hampshire is not doesn't have a certified lab, so Boston will already get overwhelmed. So going through UMass is so much better for us. And Dr. Rich he loves working with us small towns. We did the tick testing through him. He hires his grad students to do the testing, so he knows us and he likes working with us, and he gives us the data, like 50% of our ticks in Deerfield that were tested carried Lyme disease, so you have a 50-50 chance if you're bitten. So it's a good thing to get your tick tested if you're bit. So he knows that kind of information we get from him. All right. Total funding for the warrant articles is $1,511,000, $511,554. The bottom line, the budget of $14,987,413 is an increase of about 5.9% from last year.
What is it again? Sorry.
It's
percentage
9%.
5.9%.
5.9.
Increase.
Right. And that does not, when you write that, remember, it's offset by additional revenues that we've incorporated. Is there any questions at this point that we should research and bring back answers for everyone? John.
Why is there a special town meeting? What's the reason for that?
The reason we do special town meetings is to address money that needs to be spent this fiscal year in 16 versus 17.
We've been advised that it's not necessary, and likely this will be the last year.
Yeah.
Pardon?
We've been advised that this is not necessary, that all these articles could be addressed in a single town meeting. So this is likely the last year that this will be organized this way.
It's just that that's the way we've done it, and so we've, okay, no. We're going to change. Let's try to be updated.
Article 2 will not be spent in 16 more.
This is the South County is, I'm pretty sure it's from last year, isn't it?
Article
for this
2
year.
Is for a transfer of $57,899 from the South County EMS Enterprise Fund. Yes, that will be immediately transferred.
That's to us
happen
for
right
this
away.
Year?
It will be credited to the town in FY16.
It won't be applied.
Well, budget. Well, we can't.
Can't be.
It can't be, and it won't show up until our free cash is certified in September.
Are we doing any more articles, or is that it?
Did you have any questions on any of the?
I have a question on Article 25. If you could provide some explanation there, please.
Okay.
Because I'm not sure what that's related to.
Mark can probably address the fact that the RFP just went out. Is it right, Doug? Yeah.
It's not out yet. It needs to go before legal counsel.
Oh, okay.
According to the intermunicipal agreement between the towns of Whately, Sunderland, and Deerfield. Well, let me back up. An intermunicipal agreement is an agreement made between municipal entities. It's an agreement that can be entered into by the authority of the executive. It is exempt from Chapter 30B, and it does not need town meeting approval. That being said, the wisdom of the folks who put together the intermunicipal agreement for the EMS included a phrase that said, town meeting approval shall be required for any change in location of the service. Article 25 will be to ask town meeting to allow the service to change location. It will not specify a location. It will not specify a town. It will not specify an address. The Board of Oversight for the EMS is issuing an RFP to invite people to provide potential home space for the EMS service. When the responses from the RFP come back, they will all be reviewed. They will be scored according to the criteria published in the RFP. And recommendation will be made to the Town of Deerfield Board of Selectmen as the issuing authority. And the Board of Selectmen will be able to choose. Did I miss anything? Does that make sense?
That makes sense.
Okay.
Yes.
Relative to Article 2, is that on other town meeting warrants?
Article 2? On the special, you mean?
Yeah.
No, because this is South County. We're the fiscal agent for South County.
Okay. The letter that was presented to the selectmen by the three administrators said that it should be voted on by the three towns.
The administrative?
You established a 10% number. The statement was that it should be voted upon by all three towns. It should be an amendment to the FY16 budget.
After review by legal counsel, we've been advised that all that needs to happen is town meeting in Deerfield needs to vote to transfer the money.
So the other two towns have already paid it, so they don't need to vote.
The Board of Oversight for the EMS has agreed with this move, and based on that, the Board of Selectmen are put the article on town meeting, on the special town meeting warrant.
It's coming out of
Retained earnings, but
retained earnings, and basically it's the
usually retained earnings. And the other two towns don't get a vote.
No, they don't.
But it's on the recommendation of the three towns to the Board of Selectmen to approve it. So they get a vote. Any two towns can overrule the masses. One thing I want to say is that basically we don't have that issue. They talk through it very deliberately and come up with a really good answer that makes the ambulance service as functional as it possibly can be.
After fiscal year 15 or 16?
This is 16's money to be spent this year.
What are you going to do about fiscal year 15 if we never got any money from them?
I can't speak to, because I've heard rumors on both sides of this, but I can tell you that basically the Board of Oversight has paid whatever, have taken into consideration whatever's been asked of us from the towns. And that money, because it's being 2 years back, had a different implication. Doug, help me out with the interpretation of this. And basically the three towns collectively looked at it and said that this, let's go back 1 year, pay this year. They were willing to pay whatever the towns requested.
I think you were not able to document the first year because, remember, we got a grant for the first year, John?
No. You got a grant to get specific equipment, which you got. That was separate and different from fiscal year 15. Don't forget you also had a half a year of fiscal 14 that you were working on this whole process. Nobody's asked you about money for that. But fiscal year 15, we did the entire year. We've asked you about it last year. It's about time you stepped up to the plate and filled it. And there's no reason you can't take it out of return earnings. When we had the meeting here for SCIM, Mark was here and Tom was here. And we asked a question about it. And Tom's answer was, well, you're only going to have to bill it to yourself and pay 52%. That's not the issue at all. The issue is very simple. We've already paid it. The money's sitting in the account with the $502,000, and all you got to do is bill it, and you have to vote it on town meeting at a 90% rate to accept the money. Now, to me, I think that's irresponsible if we don't turn around and ask for money that we've already earned for a full year. Did I say it clear enough?
Sure.
Okay.
And you're totally entitled to your feelings.
That's my opinion.
Right, and we thank you for your opinion.
You'll hear about it again on town meeting.
I'm sure we will. Bruce?
On Article 25, I'd like to clarify some conversation that was made at a SCIMS meeting, and I tried to play it back on my computer, but the audio would not download. But Mr. Finn was... I had only caught it right smack in the middle of the sentence. Mr. Finn was telling the Board of Oversight how the town of Waitley and the town of Sunderland could turn around and sue the town of Deerfield or call the state, and they would be in the violation of some state ordinances about providing services to the town. Now, was that in regards to potential changes to this this allowance for Article 25?
That would be, if I remember the context correctly, that was a supposition as to what could happen if town meeting failed to fund South County EMS.
Okay. Yeah.
If town meeting in Deerfield said, we're not funding it, zeroing out, that's it, we're walking away without notice, that would be a violation of the intermunicipal agreement, and that could give cause for the other two towns to at least bring it to court and require the town of Deerfield to fund it for at least one more year in accordance with the terms of the IMA.
But
that was the context, I believe.
But the IMA...
I'm not a lawyer. I don't even play one on TV.
The IMA says that you give a year's notice.
So this document that has suggested changes, is all these changes subject to this Article 25?
I don't know what document you're looking at.
He's asking, does the IMA, all the changes fall under the same guidance and controls of this article? Is that correct?
That's what I'm asking. If,
yeah, if he's asking, does all the changes on the IMA
fall under Article
follow 25? This article that's there for changes? Is it all approved by the Board of Selectmen?
My understanding, and again, this is what I've been advised by Towns Council, is that as it is an intermunicipal agreement organized under Chapter 40, Section 4A, if memory serves, that an IMA may be negotiated, agreed to, and executed by the executive in a town or by the highest elected position or the chief executive officer of any other municipal body without legislative approval, assuming the funding is there, assuming there's funding to support it.
Yeah,
The IMA between the three towns for the EMS, the only portion of it that needs to come before town meeting for ratification is in regards to a change in location or the addition of another member town. And that's internal to the IMA. That was built into this agreement.
Right.
Let's say, I'm trying to think of a good example. Let's say we wanted to change the word Town of Deerfield to simply fiscal agent all the way through the document. I'm using that as an example. That change, if that were it, and the three town executives agreed to that, I believe that change could be done without town meeting approval.
Correct.
As an example.
Does Article 25, quick question, does Article 25, with that being said, and you had mentioned RFPs as far as new location being put out there, and if nobody proposes anything and this language is approved at town meeting, then does that mean that the vote at the town meeting, if it was approved, Article 25 was approved, that that would allow the Board of Selectmen to vote and move to Whately without town approval, town meeting approval?
It would depend on the language of the motion at town meeting.
Okay. I was just asking, because I didn't know, I just wanted clarification, that's all.
I think it would depend
on the language of the motion at town meeting.
Yeah. I think that the hope of the board is that a fair and equitable place to have a place to live.
Right.
Can be fulfilled, and the RFP is a fair and equitable way of taking it out of the politics and making it happen. Where our assumption is if the RFP is approved by the reviewing body and goes in front of the Board of Oversight and then comes to the town of Deerfield for final approval, then they're going to move to wherever that RFP is located. And the RFP specifies a target zone, which allows a consistent response time for the population as a whole. It doesn't take any particular person and say that you will get better or you'll get worse service. It is for the greater good of all the people that are being served, and the greater number of people have to be fulfilled or actually served.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks for the question.
Is there anything that anybody would like us to generate information for? Do you have any questions that we didn't answer? Bruce?
I think we should generate information on Article 24, which shows the parcels of land that we just voted on to be disposed of.
Okay. Would a plot plan think would be how many parcels were we going to do?
We don't know yet.
Oh, okay.
The list has not been generated yet.
It might be, okay. I don't know. But somehow we should
okay.
be able to identify where they are. That's all.
So, how about a neighborhood plot plan kind of thing? So people would know where the street and some references. Okay. That makes total sense. Thank you, Bruce. Is there anything else that anybody had a suggestion for information? Okay. Well, thank you very much for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for doing it.
We'll try to get better at the presentation so it's not so confusing. We'll probably break up that first part so that... All right. Thank you for your input on breaking up that first part so that it's not so long before we actually get a bottom line to what it
deals
with.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Well, thank you for your time.
Our next meeting, Selectman's meeting, is April 20th.
What's your last name?
Doug?
I will. Okay. Do you mind if I get your number real quick?
No. 413.
413. Bruce.
How many Bruces are here?
One, four.
You're on the list.
I'll ask him right now as soon as I can
track
him.
He's on the list.
Do you mind if I get your name?
It's
Jack Davey.
Oh, okay, sure.
Were you asking a question?
The email.
Sure.
How nice to see you.
Sure. 413. Oh, yeah, I think your number was there, but just in case.
Yeah, sure. 522.
522?
382.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Jeff's over there on the gray sweater.
Sure.
See you, Jack.
Need an executive session?
Can we continue on with the meeting? So,
yeah. I apologize, yes, of course. Oh,
sorry. No, not, it was not meant to that way.
Are you an exec?
I have to take a motion to.
This is the capital committee.
Yep. We know, Kevin. Thank you. We're still live. We have to move to go into an executive session. Thanks, though.
Yes.
Is it possible to get
he's pressured.
Excuse me, we need to continue on, so if we can get you to move along.
Now we can hear you.
I'm trying to be heard. I don't know.
I'm talking loud. What's happening? Because I was talking into this. I was talking.
We couldn't hear you.
Oh.
I didn't talk much, so you didn't miss much.
To make you feel better. I mean, to
Well, it's not posted yet. No, it hasn't.
No, it hasn't been posted.
Still alive?
Thank you very much.
Standing by to continue the meeting.
I'd love to have it.
Standing by to continue the meeting.
We'll get it. Thank you very much. Very good.
We're still. Oh, are you done? Did you take us off? Okay. You're just shutting that down. Okay.
We're not live, are we?
Yes, we are.
We are. I've been trying to tell you this for the last 30 minutes.
We need a motion to go into executive session.
I make that motion that we go into executive session.
For purposes of litigation?
Litigation.
I'll second that motion. All those in favor by roll call vote.
Aye.
Mark Gilmore, aye.
Coming out only to add.
Yes.
Executive session to adjourn.